Dire team ban. Radiant team ban.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back. We're getting right back into the C playoff action here. It's our first match of today to close out all of the C qualifier and get that one team that's going to make it to Manila to compete the major. It is Mineski versus TNC. I'm here with Purge once again. And Purge, would you believe it? A lot of people expected TNC to still be able to just kind of stride their way, but here they are, game number three against Mineski.
I look at that game as just a little bit of a misstep. I think TNC was in control most of the time. They played the same style that they normally do. They made great moves. They clearly outperformed team fights so many times. Like the jungle team fight, the second jungle team fight, it was always them initiating, always them doing good damage. I just felt like their items didn't quite transition. The Slaughter just barely didn't match up well. And they lost that one fight, and Slark got picked off a couple times. So I would look at that game and be like, I don't feel like criticizing either team too much. I think it's clear that TNC's better than Mineski, but Mineski can definitely win. And going over their history, they've kind of gone back and forth based on trades. I mean, if you look at ESL Manila, Mineski won the qualifier for the Philippines. TNC was there. Mm-hmm. They got to the finals, but they lost. That's why they were not at ESL Manila.
So vengeance.
Definitely vengeance. I mean, I'm sure TNC was a little salty about that, but... And think about, it's kind of also funny that the major that TNC might make it to is the one that's down the street.
Oh, yeah.
Literally in their same country.
That's
instead
probably
of like,
better for them. I mean,
oh, yeah,
in front of the homeland. And those, you were there, right?
Yeah, I mean, it was amazing.
I knew it was going to be hype as hell, but they were hype for everyone, not just their own teams.
Yeah,
like, they were hype for
they really
Dota.
Were. I the way that I would describe Filipinos is they're just like... They're hyper focused on what they are doing or what they care about.
Yeah.
Whether they're driving, they're like, I'm gonna get there as fast as I can, no matter who I screw over, or the way that they go to lands. They just get super pumped and watch. So, hype cheers, and I can't wait to see the same thing with TNC.
Love them, Filipinos.
If I can make it there.
I married one, so. I'm
oh yeah, that's right. I guess you have some personal experience in cuisine and stuff like that.
Oh, lumpia is just delicious, but the balut, I mean, I don't know.
No, I won't go for that.
That's
I had like
breakfast all in one right there. It's
yeah,
not
I guess
really...
it really is probably good protein, right?
Yeah.
Maybe some calcium.
Chicken and eggs.
don't even have to eat the shell.
Calcium too, instead of your yogurt substitute.
Yeah.
Sure, but here we are. Let's talk about it. Game number three, Mineski. Well, actually, TNC open. Pretty much have we seen them open the game so far. They get their Witch Doctor, and they go right for the Slardar again, probably for Sam the Man.
Mm-hmm.
Game two, we already mentioned, was not his best showing. Game number one, though, was a huge stride for him, so he's going to look to shake it off for game three. And they go right for the secondary support. Tremendous lockdown capability already from TNC as they get the Lion.
Yeah, and the burst damage, which is maybe something they were missing in the last game. They couldn't finish off the heroes once they had enough mantas on heroes, because it was tanking the Omni Slash not getting kills. Slardar wasn't scaling mid to late. He did, I think, he missed a couple spells early, but he played quite well up until the, I don't know, 45 minute mark, and then his hero just wasn't quite effective with the due to them not completely stomping team fights. So Lion provides a good solution to that. More lockdown, more gank potential. They can burst heroes easier with Finger of Death, for example. The limitation is who's the other support they had last game?
For Mineski?
It was Rubick.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah.
Great teamfight hero if you steal the right spells. He played it absolutely
which he did.
Perfectly
Man.
As you could, pretty much.
Yeah.
But Lion, in a lot of ways, much easier. Don't have to wait for the spells to be stolen. You don't have to react to the Eclipse coming out. You just kill them before they cast Eclipse.
Oh, yeah.
So that can be good. They do get a Slark in response, though, so that's a little scary due to it kind of being a counter against stuns. But with that said, if they initiate first, especially with a spell like Hex, they can definitely chain stun, kill Slark.
Oh, for sure.
As long as Puck's not there to counter initiate. So the fights are still going to be pretty interesting. But I like that we basically have the exact same drafts, but just some minor alterations. TNC says the solution is Lion rather than Rubick. And Mineski says, all right, now we actually will adjust to your build.
And they now go back to what worked out for him so nicely in game number one. That game number one, it was in the hands of Raven. So I don't know. I wouldn't put past TNC. They could still make a role change up here. But all we could talk about in that game number one was how ridiculously farmed Raven had gotten on this gyrocopter, and that stemmed from their wonderful laning setup too. So I wonder if that's something they're going to be pushing for again to make sure he has that great laning experience and that good start to just end up being a force. We'll have to see.
Definitely could be, and good matchups still. Their opponents go for a Darkseer, which will synergize very well with Slark in the early mid game. Mm-hmm. But in the laning stage, Gyro doesn't care about this. He's generally seen as the carry that is best against Darkseer while still being a standard pick without going too weird and going like Lifestealer or even though the Lifestealer is a bit iffy sometimes, but ranged hero, lots of nuke damage, very high movement speed, can chase down Darkseer.
Oh, yeah.
He'll be very effective here. If he gets behind, Slark's probably going to punish him, and Enchantress is a very good solution throughout the game due to her impetus shots going through BKB and high armor, both of which Gyrocopter usually has, but I think it's a good pick here. Flat Cannon will be great against the pushes. Enchantress actually is a little threatened by that as well, and just getting tanky and team fighting well. TNC did it amazing in game one. Let's see if they can do it again. Oracle ban.
Oracle ban. What are they going for? Batrider probably.
God. Well.
But they have last pick. So they're four. Or
do
you
they?
Know, they do.
Oh, yeah, they, yeah,
this
they
is
do.
The weird thing. That's so. That is really weird though.
But their opponents already have Puck, Darkseer. That's off lane and mid. Slark's their other hero. They can't get a Batrider, right? Surely. Well, no. They actually need another support, which is why they banned Oracle.
Nah,
so,
I don't know why Oracle.
Okay,
though. Is Oracle's not?
It's the back counter, really. That's what you see it as. Avenger's already on. Oracle's
well,
now gone. They're gonna grab
end
back. Surely.
Is Q? Does it purge off amp damage? It's a
it
soft
does.
Purge, so it can.
It does. Yes. But that's not that amazing.
I mean, it's not like a
well,
end all be all to get it, I guess.
Okay, it does counter their three heroes, like we said. They've already got some stun counters, such as Slark. I mean, the other thing they could pick is Abaddon. They could just pick Abaddon right now as their other support for the goal
yeah.
of canceling stuns, which is what Oracle does. But Oracle definitely does make things a little harder. Like, if you look at TNC's lineup, they do scale, but they're not ultra-fast scaling. It's more like they do need to burst. The burst is important. Gyro, Cooldown, Rocket Barrage, Slardar, those heroes, after the first, like, 2 seconds of combat, they're a little bit out of steam. So if you put an Oracle on top of that and hypothetically buy Slark like 5 seconds of DPS or remove a crucial stun that lets him ulti, which breaks the whole initiation, then
yeah.
it can completely change a team fight. So I think this is like one of the few times that even if they don't pick bad, I think it's a good Oracle ban here because that one hero could change everything. Same with Puck. If they initiate on Puck somehow, Blink Hex, for example, Oracle could just change the whole team fight.
Yeah.
Like ulti Lion plus Slardar, for example, and boom. They're screwed at that point as the counter initiation comes.
It's probably me just my lingering thoughts from Star Ladder. Star Ladder, we saw very limited success with Oracle unless
yeah.
it was the perfect counter pick against like a Darkseer or a Batrider.
Yeah.
Outside that, we saw teams getting it just maybe for like the lockdown potential of a Beastmaster, but he really never became much of a problem. Obviously, we're not able to watch every region that's been playing here in the qualifier to see like how his success has been so far, but it does feel a bit peculiar. But you're right, you make a great case for it, and I know for a fact if you do like a great Fortune's End on someone like a Slark, he walks over the Shadow Dance, he's going to come back with full life easily. All
yep.
that regen gets doubled right away.
Oh yeah,
it's ridiculous.
That's a good point, actually.
It's
all
really
you'd
good.
Have to do is press his R button immediately
yeah,
afterwards,
he's gonna
and
be fine.
Boom, 4 seconds of how much? 8% of his total HP.
7%. It's even better than a heart, and
so,
a heart will give you like a
yeah.
1,000.
So
even
at
on
16
cooldown.
With Oracle ulti on, he's getting 14% of his current HP per second. Which quad multiplied, that's like half his HP. Guaranteed.
Guaranteed.
Not even counting extra Oracle heals. That would be a really fantastic combo.
They offer the Crystal Maiden, though. So they'll get the mana regen benefit. It's not typically
okay.
against like your Enchantress or anything like that. Not really against illusion-based heroes. I don't know if it's just the safe pick or...
I like it, actually. When I'm picking CM and solo queue, usually the reason I don't want to open with it is because they're just going to pick Slark or something like that. Or Jug, and then you're just kind of screwed. But those ganking carries don't exist on TNC's team, with the exception of now Dragonite if he goes like Shadowblade. So I think it's actually an okay CM pick, especially because it can limit what Slardar does. Overall, really good nuke damage. Her ultimate can be good, force a stun on her instead of a core. I sort of like it. Not to mention, four of her heroes actually do really enjoy that mana regen. Darkseer, definitely. Slark
oh, yeah.
in lane, Puck, and even Enchantress a little bit, and more so late game. They're going to love that aura. So I actually kind of like this build. Not to mention Nova did get buffed. If you max that skill out, it's on a 9-second cooldown with 4.5-second slow uptime. So you can reduce attack speed and movement speed by a lot if you just stay alive, which she can sort of do this game. If
oh,
there's
yeah.
a Slark again or a highly mobile carry, she's dead. But Gyro, Dragonite, I think she can make this work. Maybe it's scary with Slark or Slar, but I think it's okay. I think it's an okay pick.
Now, let's talk a bit about that last pick, though, for the Dragonite. Something we don't get to see very often, but has been seeing some light. Obviously received quite a bit of love in this last patch. in particular, I believe, with his Dragon's Breath and the damage that it's able to kind of take away is a bit better. So you'd figure that already it's going to be a huge boost for him in that mid lane. And then a lot of the items that he would typically go for have been buffed. So there's a lot of indirect buffs there, too. We don't see it very often, but like, you know, stuff like the armlet a bit, or even a Silver Edge here and there.
The Silver Edge as well. We played against the Silver Edge one game in the open qualifiers, and he built it on Dragonite, turns Dragonite into a pseudo Slark. Like, you go to lanes, you get kills, while also being able to team fight and push very well. So just having like a tanky mid hero that has pretty darn good burst damage, for them to pop up with a stun somewhere, it changes how you play the whole game. So even if he just buys a Shadow Blade, then all of a sudden Mineski has to really limit how they play the game, and that just kind of sucks. Like, from a support standpoint, really limits what they can do. And then if you get Silver Edge on top of that, Enchantress is countered. So then at that point, Dragonite can start just getting solo kills and transitioning well. With that said, there's a lot of magic nukes on Mineski. It's a ton, actually. Puck, CM, Slark, Iron Shell on Slark, and Enchantress goes through BKB. So BKBs are not a good solution this
game. Can Darkseer make it in time to get the ward? No! Lion's here with boots and says, get the hell out of here. Get off my lawn. And that ward is not going to be going down.
I'm actually really happy that Cuckoo did this here. It's not so much of he just happened to predict the Darkseer as possible, but they have two supports, actually. They're doing a regular tri-lane, and if that's the case, you've got to make sure that you don't get your small camp blocked. They do have the sentries, so they could block it, but an easier way to do that is you just TP to lane.
Yep.
Because you'll get there before they do. The offlane's a little bit farther away. Protect your safe lane, don't let them get the ward down, and this is going to guarantee that their supports will be able to scale better in the mid-game. And I feel like too many teams are letting their experience get behind on their supports just because of the tome. Like, I've been seeing this trend. Supports like level 3 by 8 minutes, and you know, last patch I feel like that just didn't happen as much. Teams are more willing to be like, oh, we actually need to get levels on our supports. I know there's like comebacks and things like that you can do, but just pulling sometimes is really important. Get the fast level 6, especially with these two supports. Both of them get really strong at 6, so you got to pull with at least one of these guys to let them catch up, give the other guy the experience to him.
Yeah, we'll have to see if they decide to do that and which one will be the case here, as they want to put
Witch Doctor
on trying to keep the Darkseer out of lane. Witch Doctor could certainly benefit a lot, as maybe Lion just the better zoner in the lane also.
Yeah, exactly. That's why he's got boots as well. The support items are all purchased by Witch Doctor. You can actually buy all the support items on one hero now. It's actually like that a lot.
Thank you, Ice Frog. It's just wonderful. Yeah,
dude, isn't it the best playing support now? You buy support items and you're like, I can get two sets of regen and two Iron Wood Branches and a Clarity, and I bought stuff.
And if I take out a ward at the beginning, I get an extra 100 gold back? Wonderful.
It's actually so fun, because now you can alter your supports a bit. You can always put a boots on one, and it's not like completely breaking the other support. It's a cool way to play. They're definitely going to focus on zoning the Darkseer here. They're trying to actually get him to come forward.
Come in with just your Ion Shell. They make their move. They got the cast. They are going to be able to connect with the Impale and a Rocket Barrage. This is their best chance on getting it here, but he quickly eats up the Tango, gets the regen brought in.
He broke his salve.
Salve going to be broken. That's devastating for the Darkseer, but he will walk away with his life.
That made it all worth it. Killing that Salve there, completely worth it. Because now, when he goes back to lane, he'd have to use like 3 tangos. He's just going to double spam and leave.
Yeah, can't get close enough, though, to try to get that level 2. Enchantress.
Is he dead?
Creeping in from behind, bottom lane.
He might
lane.
Die.
Will they get the kill? They're looking to go for it while this
one
happens
more.
Mid lane.
Two more.
No, they want it. Oh, the first play was mid lane at that same moment. Can they still get it? Please don't make me leave. Okay, they
committed.
Are going.
Cuckoo's
going
stun.
In. He missed the stun. Now he's trapped.
The Iron Shield's on the wrong person.
And he's got a head down bottom. Oh, that was so awkward. Unfortunately, they're not going to be able to get the committed kill for the Darkseer here. And as mentioned, the kill actually happened the mid lane. We'd scoped it out. Enchantress swooping in from behind to be able to get a wonderful first blood gank onto Teehee's Dragonite in the mid lane.
Sorry to pull your camera away there.
No, I mean, I don't blame you. They were also engaging for that Darkseer. Yeah. It looked pretty damn close. And
he was trying to Clarity double spam the Iron Shell and then possibly go back to Fountain maybe, or sit back and double again, but they caught him again. They waited for it with the lane ward. So luckily they didn't die, but boy, they were like so close to getting that kill 3 times or so, and at least no one died. But Darkseer is still level 1. That's the important thing.
Yeah.
It's kind of been useful what they did, despite it not going perfect.
They look like they try to make a move here for Sam. They had the sprint active and ready to go, and Cass, you do not want to get the arms here. Courier mid lane in trouble. It's down. The summit bird will fall once again as the house tumbles forward. Courier down. This is a good way for the Dragonite to get a bit of recovery here, but look who's coming back once again. Smoked up and ready to go. Jules on the Enchantress here, looking for an opening. Ben-Hur hanging close, begins the right click and the Dark Pact, which doesn't quite connect, but they're going to be able to get a nice little net.
Great stun.
AU steps in, but no coconut yet. Does have it now. It's not going to matter. It comes a bit too late. The damage had been done, and it looks like Mineski will get the second kill now. 2-0, both of them on this mid lane Dragonite.
It was really nicely done by Jules there. He got a little lucky on creeps due to having the net and the clapper, because the net set up the easy pounce, but the stun wasn't enough. He's actually not survivable yet on Dragonite, surprisingly. He's got boots picked up now, so that'll help him a bit. The Witch Doctor did his best. Maybe they'll die here, actually.
Okay, Coconut. Can they get a second bounce? Pax leaps. He's out of there, and he'll salve up and be good.
Dark Pack saved him big time.
I never heard anyone call this creep the clapper, though, so.
Oh, really?
I might take that from you.
It's a little bit easier. Thunderclap, man.
Yeah.
It's better than Tomato. Unprotected or sex.
Oh, for sure.
He's beefy, dude. If I was a creep,
you'd want to be
that
guy?
Definitely hang out with the Hope Bear.
Leap in again. Man, lots of hate towards this mid lane on the side of TNC. Mineski looking to go hard on this one, but Jules not going to be able to get a kill this time. This Witch Doctor might be stuck on babysitting duty now in this mid lane for how much harassment's been coming their way. This Puck now boasting a big 19-9 CS. Dragonite at 12-6. He does begin to suffer quite a bit. And I do want to scope out how the farm's been going on these side lanes, which have been a bit more quiet, and that's when things get scary. Remember the first game, Raven just all of a sudden was out of control. He's second on CS, 20-8. This Darkseer, who had been kind of nerfed down a bit at the start of this game, we could see a bit of a deja vu here for the Gyrocopter if things continue to go forward.
Yeah, especially with him doing his best to zone the Darkseer, he is still a little bit behind where he should be. So I think it's going all right for Mineski as a whole. These mid ganks have been really affected by Jules. So. Yeah. Really solid play from him, but they got to stabilize a bit. How are the levels on the other supports? Oh, they're doing a smoke gank top for sure. A Lion TP into the top lane. Oh, this is actually pretty unexpected. He probably just showed on lane, TP'd to the tier 2 top as Witch Doctor went back to heal. And Sammate's level 4, they can maybe get Puck. It's a little hard. Hex? Okay,
oh,
they got
okay. Puck just happened to move right on forward, but unfortunately he's right into a Hex, but they phased before the stun. Coconut's going to be there. Raging Potato jumps over with the orb, and look at this. Mineski managed to turn it around beautifully with Jules intercepting and helping out. They quickly take down two. They're looking for three. The orb, even with the move speed, not going to be able to get the catch on that one. AU is able to sidestep it a bit, but still considering pursuing him. Nonetheless, a huge fight again. Wow. Mineski really firing on all cylinders for game number 3 Purge. Now moving ahead 4-0.
That one was mostly a mistake actually from TNC. Very, very rare mistake, but Lion level 3 has one of each skill. The Sar stunned late because he expected a longer stun duration on Earthspike. If his stun wasn't late, Puck would have died right at the start. It would have been completely fine.
Okay. Sam is able to get a nice little forgiving kill on the Crystal.
Oh, he's got a double.
Potato, who goes in to try to help out, orbs into this fight, so he finds himself in trouble when the new crush comes up. And just like that, Sam says, I'm going to get myself back on the board. I'm going to get my team on the board. And they pull ahead with 2 kills.
I gave up on him. I look somewhere else, and all of a sudden, oh, there's a kill. Cool. And I look up, and there it is. Stun off cooldown. So simple. Great kill on him. Level 6 now. 700 gold in the bank. That gets him back in it. All of these last ganks have just been like tearjerkers for TNC fans, but they're coming back, man.
This squares things back up in the early game for him nicely. Uh-oh, and he's going to find himself in another bit of trouble here. Jules with a DD rune now, looking to move on in, but Jules only level 5, doesn't have the impetus in any sort of chase. Sam will pop his sprint and make it out from trouble, and Jules will just simply grab up the creep and turn and face elsewhere. Teehee has been able to kind of get himself to his own little level 6 here.
Yeah.
But still very hesitant in this mid lane as long as this Enchantress continues to be missing on the map.
I think TNC looks for a possible mid gank soon. Witch Doctor is definitely under level.
Uh-oh. They made their move for the bottom lane Darksteer. He was able to get the Surge off, and that's going to be enough for him to kind of step away. If that Surge was not there, he would have been dead for sure.
Yeah. Just got to get that off fast enough. Lion will hit 4 from this next creep. Sardar shifts to the top lane to try to defend the tower, but it's very difficult, especially with the Tornado from the Wildkin. Nice creep here. So off lane will most likely die. A little bit of pause for whatever reason. But the Darkseer has been getting kind of away with everything. He's got a lot of last hits, 28. Jar hasn't quite been able to shut those down as hard as he wants to. He's just now picking up the Helm of the Dominator to start stacking. But the pressure from Mineski has been really good. Jules has been playing a great Enchantress. Lots of mid ganks, offlane ganks, lane pressures, being exactly where he needs to. Like, the fact that he was there as they did that gank on the puck was amazing.
Like, it's very similar to how, like, I see, like, Lanham play Enchantress. He's very proactive, very aggressive with it. Loves to put a lot of attention towards the mid lane. Loves to secure the mid lane, so working out nicely for Jules here. And Teehee pops his dragon form now, and so he's going to utilize this in the mid lane a bit, and or maybe just farm on the side. But
I would like to see them do a setup with the Dragonite. He's a little behind. Getting a kill would make a big difference. They kind of can versus Slark. They could do a stun into a stun, possibly kill.
Coil, top lane. They're looking to go for Sam here.
He did this completely right.
But that's the end of it. TP will actually be canceled, and a coil is going to be on cooldown.
Sometimes you have to judge whether or not it's worth breaking it, and there it easily was. We can tell because of map packs, obviously, but if you only see Puck in the lane, especially the level 1 Dream Coil, the stun duration isn't super high to break. It's 1.5 seconds, so it's like a regular stun. It would do 200 damage in. It's actually kind of a weak. Oh,
they're making a move for Teehee. There's the Nova. That's the slow. Sets up for the pounce right now, and they can't commit for it. He tries to walk away under the Shadow Dance. We'll get stunned up, but that will be the end of this skirmish. Swing and a miss for Mineski on trying to make their jump for Dragonite.
He's getting a little hard to kill now. Treads Bracer, plus all that armor. Until Enchantress hits 6, for example, it'll be a bit iffy.
Oh yeah, she's still not 6. So it's, she had been kind of grinding around this mid lane area, but not really bringing in a lot of XP. So maybe looking for a setup at the top lane to change things a bit, but she continues to just try to hide in the shadows. We'll see now. Looking to make her move. Oh, Sam pops the sprint. Amps up the illusion and
got him.
We'll quickly get the hell out of there. Doesn't want to risk it.
Yeah. Slar's on a pretty solid position at the moment. Again, he picks up the infused raindrop. Quite good this game. Stopping a puck nuke could make a difference here.
Oh, yeah.
Especially with a little bit of sprint damage block can be nice.
A freeze from Crystal Maiden. Yeah, any of that.
Dude, Dragonite CS is actually ridiculous. He's got 48 last hits right now. That was a stacked medium camp, so they're not quite the same as a regular, but. And one of them was Mud Golem, but he's been farming really well.
He caught up real nice, like, after all those ganks.
How does he have more farm than Slark, actually? Like,
yeah, no one's even approached the Slark. No one's like giving the Slark trouble.
And
has
he even rotated? Did he go in the offlane?
I don't think so.
I mean, like, I guess he pressured that one time and he ulted.
Bit awkward here. Mineski very deep in TNC territory, up by their secret shop right now, floating around this mid lane. You know what, though? It's pretty standard from game number one. They know that this camp is probably trying to be stacked up for the gyrocopter, and they want to make sure they kind of can control that playing area.
Yeah, I really like the words from Mineski here. They're constantly outside of everybody's lanes. They don't want to let TNC leave the base, and they would love to do that. Leave the base, maybe get some ganks off, turn it into a push, but because Mineski's constantly on the aggression, it's really limiting what Dragonite should normally be doing, which is easily pressuring a tower at no disadvantage to yourself. But because they're getting so many ganks off, and now they're rotating, it's harder for Gyro to farm. And this is exactly why he basically left his lane. Because at this stage, Dire's usually going to shift to the safe lane. They've mostly focused on mid and top all game. But now's a great time to go pressure safe lane. So,
but I mean, he's finding great farm in the jungle. And this does allow the Witch Doctor to kind of build up to level 6 now in the bottom lane, which is nice. But the problem is he's a Witch Doctor alone. And there's a Slark chasing him. And Slark knows that. Oh, yeah. Nice little juke right there. An ankle breaker. Prevents the Slark from making the jump. And he's just like, I'm going to hide under this tower now. Slark eats a bit of damage. He actually eats a lot of damage from that. And he will TP out of there before Crystal Maiden can catch him off with the Nova.
That's why you put the support there, because when the gank eventually comes, then it's only support dying, and you don't feel the need to TP a lot of heroes to take a fight in a place where they can easily approach you. And kind of these trees just kind of turn into a death trap at some point. So he gets out. They'll turn that into mid-pressure instead to make up for this offlane pressure.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully for them, they can get a kill.
They
make
have
all the difference.
Plenty of time to work with this dragon form here as they bring the tower just below its halfway point, but TNC not really looking to converge. They continue to stack up that mighty ancient camp here for their gyro.
How does this guy have 97 freaking last hits? Like, it actually blows my mind.
It continued to just go up and up, and I'm telling you, it's like they just sleep on him, and he's just down there like, well, no problem. I got waves and waves and waves of farm here.
Is this guy like the best farmer in the game? Like, I know that's weird to say, but how often do you see him put up numbers this huge? Like 99 at 11 and a half minutes. The other guy that did this the other day was Sam H. He played a safe lane Beastmaster and he had like 100 last hits at, or he had like something ridiculous like this, like 100 last hits at 12 minutes. It was just crazy. It's mostly jungle efficiency, and he did get some stacks from his allies and stuff, but man, these farm numbers are actually ridiculous. He's just ahead.
And Teehee may not be as glorious and as farmed as him, but he's getting his own way now. Does he go for a Blink Dagger also himself? I mean, he's got about 1,800 gold saved up on this DK.
Yeah.
Or is it like a armlet? I haven't personally seen a whole lot of DK in actual play.
Get armlet.
In this patch, but...
Oh, okay. Sometimes armlet, Blink Daggers, drums, things like that are a lot more standard for sure.
Ooh, smoke moving in, but look at this play from Mineski. Beautiful jump in three-man silence from Raging Potato, but they're still going to be able to get off the quick burst and finish off the Slark. Not enough to stop him. Mineski looked like they were in a better position to stop this smoke movement, but TNC still get the job done, and they might be looking for more. A jump in from Raging Potato, looking to get the finish for Lion. He will be able to do it. And it jumps over to the orb before the Gyro can intercept here. But uh-oh, Gyro didn't see him. Passes right on through, and that may be the end of it. A one-for-one trade, still a better one for TNC to take down that mighty Slark. And now they're going to transition it into this push on the mid lane. Again, Dragon form happening here. And oh, they spotted out. Slark is... Oh, they found him now. They jump in. They crush right on his head. They followed up with a coconut. They have a Dragon Tail if necessary. Actually, they don't, but it doesn't matter. He goes down. DK picks up the Blink Dagger, and... That makes it a two-man drop for TNC.
How did they find him?
Yeah, I don't know. Deduction, maybe? I guess they just figured he slipped in there. The ward.
I didn't see the initiation. I just saw that Slarder was on top of him with a stun, but...
He just blinked in there. Like, blinked right on him.
Weird. Okay.
And the crush came so fast, it's just like he knew he was there.
I mean, I guess if you're going to blink for him, you might as well stun afterwards, right?
Yeah, right.
Because otherwise you're like, oh, hey, you're there, and then he just leaves.
Yeah.
So, for the best, I guess.
Good heads up for Sam on that one.
Yeah. All right, well, that was a huge pickoff. It was amazing intuition by Mineski as well on the tier 2 there, that they anticipated the Slark getting ganked. I mean, they got him ganked on purpose. In some ways, it was a bait, right? They moved Slark forward.
Yeah.
He's farming the creep wave. They're anticipating that. But really fast reaction time from the puck. As soon as the one hero smoke broke, which was CM scouting that out, instantly initiates on three heroes. Just at this level, he did actually have a lot of waning rifts, but they were able to get the hex off on the Slark, and that's what got him killed. Not sure if he got his ult off. I don't think he did. So maybe Slark mistakes, who knows, but that was a huge fight and really well played by both teams, but it did come out in TNC's favor. So game's pretty even as a whole.
TNC... The Gyro's got this ridiculous girthy stack now. He's farming down. He just picked up his Yasha, for God's sakes, and now he's going to have nearly the SMY that much closer to being completed. Meanwhile, Teehee has an invis rune, spotted out Raging Potato, throws out the orb. And he's waiting. He's got Dragon Tail ready. And assistance is on the way. Gets nice, efficient one. Attack in. There's the stun. There's the crush follow-up. And, the Darkseer's like, what happening? And then all of a sudden, they make their move for him. There's the amp damage. They're waiting for the next stun. 2 seconds. They're going to get the crush. Three-man TP to come. Can they get the kill quick and get out? Oh, Vendor's in trouble. Leaps right in. Eats a lot of damage. Is going to be forced to sidestep away with the Shadow Dance. They will be able to finish off the Slardar. Teehee now moves in. AU! Steps in with a big death ward. Will be able to get the finish for the Crystal Maiden. Bear jumps over, but he goes right into the arms of the Gyrocopter.
Oh, the
stun.
Two-man
stun comes out from Cuckoo, and that means the call-down will be right there. And another five-man wipe this series. This time it's Mineski who all hit the deck, and this will secure a tier one for TNC.
Ah, TNC fought that so well. Man, the Darkseer chase with the body blocking to buy time for the Slar stun, and... The stun into call down was beautiful, and they picked off the Slark as he leaped past. The Witch Doctor combo was amazing. Like, two heroes, Cask with the ulti. He got so much value out of that. Cleans up CM so easily. Like, they just prevented a lot of Mineski from using their skills effectively, and it became like a one-by-one situation.
Oh, that was scary there from Raging Potato. Sorry. He committed the orb for the farm, and you had a Lion and a Slardar there ready to go. They saw him orb in. They wanted to go for it, but he was quick to blink back. Got to be nervous if you're Mineski in this one now. Lots of quick initiation potential. It's only going to get worse here soon, Purge. We have 1,800 gold in the Lion, so Link is going to be coming soon.
White farmed. 16 minutes at this is really good. 2-2 and 3 for him. Overall good stats. CM is doing all right this game, but definitely behind in effectiveness of the rest of the team. And at this point, I'm like, do you really want a CM over a Witch Doctor or a Lion? And this is kind of where CM becomes a bit weak. Did we see him do anything in the early game, though? Like, I feel like he really didn't do much.
I didn't see a reason why she was picked. I feel that's pretty blunt to say.
It could have worked, but I think.
Oh, Coil bottom lane, Lion.
The creeps. Hex the creeps.
He's fine. He's got the Voodoo Restoration.
Against Sam H.
Raging Potato got him with the orb. Sam tried to go for a jump in crush, but Potato slips right behind him, gets the finish on Lion. He wanted it so bad. Back at mid lane, TNC are pushing in for the tier one. They step back. They get that value rocket point. Already put it to work to zone back anyone from coming in.
Rest in peace, Tower. No, I just feel like Cass hasn't accomplished enough in the early game. And maybe this is because he's been in a coach position. He hasn't played much recently. But I have very little recollection of CM doing anything this game. I see that he's gotten one kill and one assist. But, you know, the ganks mid were always Enchantress only. Like, maybe occasionally bring the CM with and guarantee the kill. Not that the early ganks weren't effective, but I just feel like he hasn't done that much. And Slar still got a really fast level 6, for example. So,
they're not getting value
from this hero.
It doesn't help that TNC are always first picking his best hero, Witch Doctor. So,
yeah.
Here comes the smoke, though, from Inesky. Can they turn things around here? Looks like a missed opportunity to get the catch on the gyrocopter here, but they are building up stacks, something that maybe Minesky could anticipate. But every time TNC are going for these stacks, they always have help nearby, so they understand the value of those stacks and the value of their economy while they're certainly up and ahead. Well, speaking of which, I mean, Gyro's about to get to that 10k net worth mark. I mean, the next closest for Minesky is their Slark at 6.3. He's really feeling like he's just again going to be in a league of his own.
Yeah, he's just always a little bit behind. Especially compared to Gyro, man. This guy, like, how often do you see Gyrocopters get that far ahead in net worth? This is like when Gyro first got popular and Flat Cannon was on a low cooldown.
Oh, yeah.
Amazingness.
The OP cooldown.
But this is like nerfed Gyrocopter in so many ways. He literally just got a nerf to base damage. This guy still gets every single last hit possible. Just incredible farm. Invis on the puck. He was hoping to get a free support kill, but they're staying together, and this is what they need to do, definitely. Especially with the Shadowblade picked up on Slark, they did get a revealed there at Secret Shop, at least. So they know that it's coming, and as long as Slark doesn't get kills, they are going to be completely fine this game.
And they'll try their best to at least take the ward game back here, but the ward game is still being won by TNC. They have a lot of neutral vision out on the map, I guess you could say, up and down the river here, but haven't really considered going offensive yet until they really get in, I guess, more comfortable fighting shape. Get that Gyro that much more richer, and the DK right by his side. Both of them on the verge of being able to pick up a BKB. At that point, Purge, once these BKBs come together for TNC, do you think it's kind of go time? Or
it definitely is. Because if he's got BKB, Star can't kill him at all. He's already got plus 12 armor from Dragon Blood. So if you're magic immune and you have that much armor, Slark does nothing at all. All Slark can do, pick off your supports one by one, and then hopefully let the rest of your heroes, once the BKB ends, you can deal with the Dragonite. But with BKB on DK and a Blink Dagger, he can basically initiate to set up on an important hero, either Slark or Puck, or he can follow up on the important hero that Sardar finds. And with magic immunity, he's not going to die in the team fight. Same thing with CM ulti. Like, once he has BKB, CM does nothing. Puck does pretty much nothing. Darkseer does pretty much nothing. The only hero that can kind of touch him is Enchantress. So it's definitely a really big item for him to pick up. And I like that they've been playing passively until this point, because that's clear that these two guys farm ridiculously fast. And normally you play your game around like, oh, we'll just assume that with free farm, we'll all farm the same. But these guys are just so fast at farming that they actually can just focus on this and be like, you know, if we never fight, we're going to win. We're always going to
have made their move in for the Roche Pit here. They may be able to get away with this, though. They are pretty slow at doing it here. Thankfully, they have a DD rune on their Slark.
There's the smoke on TNC.
Yeah, it's going to be too late, but this is TNC Purge.
They
don't care.
They really don't care.
They will fight outside the front door. I don't think they can do it in time.
They prefer
they're
that they have
They're not going to make it in time. They're going to try to run, but it's not going to be happening. Zem steps in. He gets a huge stun, a vacuum wall combo with a Crystal Maiden ulti. It's going to be quickly canceled out. Not going to be enough for Minesky. Look like a valiant start, but in the end, they will quickly lose three. The Roche could end up going the way of TNC, and they're not done there. The chase has begun. They look to go for the Darkseer. He tries to surge away, but eventually, Sam will catch
up. Comes that missile.
Here it comes.
75 damage.
Got him. Doesn't matter. They want the bigger prize. They step back. They go in for the Roche, and they're going to take the Aegis themselves. TNC continue to be the biggest contenders of the Roche Pit.
These guys are like so good at this game that they play it like they have map packs. Like that is what it's like. Like they got to the last Roche late in game one, but this one was perfect.
He's probably resetting his map pack right now, actually.
He's like, oh shoot, our map pack's not working.
Lag, right.
They just approached that so well. I also kind of liked how, rather than everybody running down the cliff here, approaching the Roche, that Dragonite blinked to the river north a little bit. Did you see that as they initiated?
I didn't see the blink, but I'm like, oh, Dragonite's in a position I was not expecting him to come from.
But I think they did this. Basically, if all smoke breaks and they're on the cliff, they could get like vacuumed on the cliff, or they could get five men. Dreamcoiled, for example, like the nukes are going to be towards the group of his team. So despite limiting his ability to initiate, the important thing was blink over here. That way, if there's heroes on the cliff, you can spot them, mm-hmm. or you can see. You're basically giving vision for the Slardar. It's like a very small thing, but I would never think of that myself when I'm playing, but watching other players do, it's like, oh, it makes perfect sense. Give vision to your other heroes. You've got BKB, so if you get out of position with your blink, it doesn't matter. It was a very subtle thing, but it's like little tricks like that that give you the vision to allow your allies to get those big chronos or those big stuns. And Slar got like a two-man crush, one of which was on a Puck. Puck dies instantly to the stun finger,
that's the thing,
and
like,
fight's over.
Mineski actually had a really nice vacuum wall kind of a setup as a response, but without Puck really being any sort of factor in that fight, credit to TNC for that one. There's no coil follow-up. There's no, you know, they try to get off even the Crystal Maiden ulti, but that got quickly shut down. You know, valiant effort for Mineski to have a response, but because of TNC being able to approach and get that lockdown again, there's no way for Mineski to have enough follow-up to finish him off.
Yeah, if they actually had the Puck alive there, they would have killed Gyro at least, because Gyro got down to like 20% HP, 30%. He actually got kind of low due to Vacuum and maybe some other nukes. I think the CM ulti went off a little bit longer than they expected. I got a little leg spike there, but they eventually did pick up the CM kill, and then everybody was fine. But during that vacuum wall, if they Puck combo on top of that, they very likely could have won the fight. So TNC is just showing, man, that they fight fights so effectively.
Yeah.
Their positioning is amazing. They do all the little things right that lead to them getting perfect team fights, just like game one. So they just got to close this out. They've got to feel confident after how all three of these games have gone. They're all their games to lose, basically, every single time.
We got to see, though, what Mineski can do to bring this one back. You know, they had a valiant effort in game one. We know that TNC walked away with a win there, but they found other objectives to pursue to make things very difficult, which ended up being just forcing TNC to go into a all-in finish. This time, though, those options don't seem, you know, as relevant. I mean, if this isn't working out, the Slark isn't kind of being a huge heavy hitter, which he pales in comparison right now compared to the two cores of, maybe not pales in comparison to Dragonite, but someone like a Gyrocopter, and especially when they're both get those BKBs, you know, what is plan B for Mineski, and is there even a plan B?
Get ganks off. They definitely have pretty good nuke damage. Their team fights are pretty good, but they kind of lost their window because now the BKBs are up on both heroes. Gyrocopter has one, and now Slaughter has one. So all these picks that Mineski did are very limited. Puck as well as CM, very countered in that way. So they kind of lost their window. They did move around and take a lot of towers and some advantage that way. They had a lot of great aggressive wards, but they didn't win the early game hard enough, and they didn't limit TNC's farm enough. And that was, I mean, with that said, though, if you look at their net worths, it's very clear it's only on two heroes. And that's basically because they were almost always five-man in early game. They constantly covered each other, which only leaves so much space. If you're all on the same general area in the map, you can only farm about two heroes. But the two heroes they put it on gave them a really good shot, because Slardar doesn't really need more than a Blink Dagger for him to be a good hero.
I mean, he has an armlet.
He does now, but that's because they won that last fight.
Yeah.
But the other heroes, the Gyro and the DK, those guys definitely need some items to be effective. And now those two heroes are tanky with BKBs. Now these other heroes are going to collect gold just by winning team fights as the game goes on. So it's like you sacrifice heavily on the Lion and the Witch Doctor. You get lucky by Lion playing well and eventually getting a Blink Dagger. But really, they put all the farm on those two heroes. They farm very rapidly, and it turned them into a fight where they win, get Aegis, and now they're just clearly going to catch up on all five heroes. They're going to play more standard rather than scared.
Potato, don't be tempted here. No, he's tempted. But they are not going to be able to get it. They know he's in there, though. They move in again. Sam says he's right here, jumps in, gets the crush, but it's still
they
Puck.
Can't see.
They can't see him.
Oh,
now they can. Now they can. Jumps over. This crush will miss. They even committed a ward for this one. Man, this fairy is very slippery. They go in again. They really want to get this Puck. Crystal Maiden nearby. Pops out the freezing field, but that'll get quickly canceled. And suddenly nice. Teehee showed up, but they get the finger anyways. the deal with the raging potato. They turn him into French fries at this point, and now they want to get a hold of Cass, but oh, nice little juke there.
Well, they both awarded that high ground. I didn't realize.
Mid lane, Sam's in trouble. Vacuum back, but Raven's here, and he looks to go for the Slark. Slark trying to make a move, trying to finish off the Slaughter, not going to be able to get it, and now the mighty warship strides its way north. Not going to be able to get the catch for the Slark, and oh, nice quick blink there from the Darkseer. Avoids the crush from Sam.
So just the puck kill, they countered the split push a little bit. The Dire team will know that they have a ward on the high ground. Maybe they'll defend that later or deny that, but overall a good period of minutes. Oh, catch on Dragonite.
Oh, way bottom lane. Yeah, Dragonite now alone moving out that lane here, but he does have a Shadow Blade now, so
okay,
avoids the trouble. And I wager that Crystal Maiden is going to start grabbing some dusts.
Yeah, that was actually a pretty big loss there, because Dragonite had a gem in that moment. If they were slightly proactive, guessed for the Shadowblade, or just had sentries, they would have gotten a gem and a Dragonite kill right there. That's kind of a big loss for TNC. I guess, worst case, he BKB TP'd there. So I guess no matter what, he was fine. But they could have at least forced the 9-second BKB out on the Dragonite.
TNC now, smoke deep inside their base, anticipating Mineski are going to be converging in their woods, which they're actually right about. Puck already orbed on forward, jump in Dragon Tail. They're going for Potato. They got the crush follow-up. This Puck is going to be taken out of the fight right away. And now the rest of Mineski, they look to retreat. And the chase will not be on, it looks like, at the moment here from TNC.
And because they have the gem, now all the wards die. They're just playing so well. Occasionally, you do need to do that kind of a maneuver where you move into your jungle. When you lose your tier 1 tower, it's very easy for the Dire team to get wards in there. They spend a lot of time farming there. But with the Shadow Blade and the Blinks and the Smokes, their initiation is so good that all they needed was Vision on a hero and Blink stun on Dragonite with the follow-up and Puck dies.
Oh, Finger kill. Mid lane, Crush set up. The two of them get it down. But now a Vacuum Wall, Ghost Scepter showing off on the line, looks to turn back, tries to assist, but they got the Shadow Dance, now comes in AU, Slaughter is going to be able to make it away, can they turn this around into a 3-on-2 from the side of TNC, they're looking to go for it, they get the stun on the Slark, Slark punts off the pack, moves on in, they get the finish on the Slaughter, but now Teehee shows up, jumps in, gets off the stun, they have the Death Ward now, and it begins to go to work, that is going to be a Slark taken down, Teehee on a mega kill streak for his Dragonite, and they find themselves a good answer to the catch up on the Slaughter, a better one at that.
Man, these players are so good.
They are
good. It is impressive how good all these guys are. Line did all that perfectly. I was like, he's so dead. And they, boom, Ghost Scepter right on time. Zero hits on him, you know?
Open qualifier team, you know?
Yeah.
No big deal.
See easy region, right, guys?
Yep. And we could be seeing them on the fast track to the Manila Major. But first, they got to make their way out from this game and await their opponent in the grand final. Teehee looks to end this one sooner than later. Jumps in, looking to go for Cask. Gets the stun off. Call down follow-up. We'll zone them back, and they look to reset here. They were trying to force out that Slark buyback. They're not going to get it here. AU could be in a bit of trouble. They get a nice vacuum back. They even commit the coil just to finish him off.
How did he get... I felt like a glimpse there or something. I'm not sure.
Vacuum pulled him all the way back, but he was kind of lingering a bit from the rest of his team.
Rare positioning mistake further made worse by Vacuum. So.
Yeah.
It's looking good for TNC, but the net worth scare me a bit. There's four heroes now in Mineski that are above the rest of the heroes on TNC. But
yeah.
Again, those three are very effective. Slaughter actually going for a Blade Mail this game. Kind of a cool build, especially when he's this tanky on armor. Like, for example, there's a lot of ways to make Blade Mail better. You can increase your survivability of the damage you're taking. That way you're reflecting far more than you're actually being dealt. And against a Slark, it's going to be pretty useful. Plus, it's going to affect Slark even if he's ultied.
Yep.
So now Slaughter can just kind of use this as a, all right, you can hit me, but I'm going to really deal a lot back in the meantime. And plus, you can armlet toggle.
Yeah, if he's doing it under Shadow Dance too, and he goes for the Slaughter and the Blade Mail pops out, he's just wasting time in his Shadow Dance, and I'll have to change targets at that point, and he'll eventually come out, and TNC will be able to make their strike.
Solution to Enchantress as well.
Obviously.
Lots of pure damage, and he can probably armlet toggle through some attacks. The nukes from Mineski are still a little bit weak. Teehee commits a Dragonite ult and his Shadowblade here to go try to set up a kill. He's very close to finding the puck.
Hello, Potato. Sees him now. Hits him once. Gets the stun. And tries to solo him here.
Should be fine.
He's awaiting. Maybe. Phase shift, blink, goes up north, they chase after him. Oh, can't avoid that one.
Did you see two Finger of Death there?
Yes.
Like
I think they're definitely hacking. I mean, map hacks,
clearly.
Finger hacks.
It's the only possible way. You know, like, these guys are so good at playing their heroes that, like, I care if they're hacking, but I almost don't care if they're hacking because they're so freaking good at playing their actual heroes. These guys look like tier 1 players. I genuinely mean that. They look really good.
Oh, Teehee, nice jump in. Looks at Jules here, but they have to BKB if he wants to get out some good right click. Meanwhile, they get the crush follow up. Looking to go for Ben here. That's a Slark. He's out. Over a minute. No buyback purge. And TNC really opening this game up at this point. It's 19-10, but they have easily the biggest net worth of the game. Almost have controlled the net worth the whole game. Getting closer to that 10k mark. The XP's already there. And they're looking to inch into the base now. And Raven begins to go to work. He's already got a butterfly, man. 17k net worth for him.
That's really fast. He's just like the fallback carry guy.
Yep. Jump in from Lion. Sees Jules vacuum wall right in the middle, though. There's a coil follow-up. This has been one of the best team fights for Mineski, but the Black Hand just says, get the hell back! Don't even come close. They go right in for the racks instead, but a jump in from Sam gets a good catch on Raging Potato, and now the puck is going to be taken out over a minute without a buyback. They still don't have the Slark. This could be, I don't know, close to the beginning of the end here. I mean, Rax is down. They could opt to step back and meet up with the Roche once it comes up, but they still have 8 seconds without the Slark. It looks like it may be the former here. They step out with their winnings. They're happy with this. They know that this is game 3. They'll opt for the tier 2 bottom instead.
I mean, it's definitely worth it. I mean, yeah, it's too early in the game to just go all in. Like, all the death timers are way too low, especially when you're beating a team. Got like a 15k net worth right now versus Mineski. Their heroes are scaling better. The Slark's just behind. This may be Mineski going down to the lower bracket. They have a good history against the other two teams that were knocked down, but right now TNC looks like they're gonna go on ahead to the grand finals. Yeah. Most likely. Not over yet though.
Not over yet. Like, we have seen bigger swings.
Those vacuum walls have been pretty high damage thus far. Yeah. And making illusions of things like even like Slardar, Gyro, Dragonite. These guys have bought a lot of primary stat items, so if they get a good vacuum wall into something like a CM ulti, it could be really game-winning, but there's still those BKBs that they have to deal with, so possibly split farm or split gank when they're solo, or get them to waste BKBs, disengage, and get out. That's so tough with how mobile Dragonite is and how hard to kill he is.
Ooh, scans out here.
Is that going to scan?
I don't think it's scanned anyone.
Radiant scan.
Yeah, but I don't think caught wind of anybody. They were hoping to catch someone there, maybe to go for a quick jump here. Teehee looking to move in. Uh-oh. Darkseer a bit out of position, but they actually jump into the base where they have that vision. Not just once, but twice. Double obs to make sure they can get this high ground vision. Now they make their move. BKBs are popped. It's TNC looking to go for the finish. They've taken out the Slark. No buyback there, and this could have done it. They will easily be able to move down and below for this Rax. If they can get the finish on this puck, that would certainly be the nail in the coffin here for Mineski, and they're going to be able to get it purged. It looks like they might have done it, and that will be game. TNC will be your first C qualifier team to make it into the grand final.
Not extremely surprising. Definitely a very close series, though. It looked a little scary for them. Mineski took a great 3-game set, especially game 2. Really well played by Mineski. All 3 games, I think they played amazing. But they just were not the same as what TNC provided in terms of crispness of ganks. Strength of their cores, always playing well. Like, every single game, every single person on TNC at worst played just pretty good, like, but most of them played like really well, really good, consistently. Yeah. Every single game. I don't know if these guys grind solo queue, but like I said before, they're all like 7k and above players, so that's, you're talking like the top of the top. Getting 7k is not even easy in the slightest.
And you were talking about a bit for this kind of a team and how they have that kind of versatility. And I've only been able to experience this one best of three, but I could see it. I mean, with the exception, of course, of Sam. He played Slardar every single game.
Well, yeah, but I vouch for Sam. Sam's also very good.
Yeah.
The only thing that limits his ability to, like, cascade is he goes Tranquil Boots, because then you can't turn into a carry as well.
Yeah.
But I really feel like he's equally as good as the rest of his teammates. And some games he really overperforms as well.
So with this means Mineski will now be bumped down into the lower bracket where they do have orange tearing. I hope I said that right.